Kia ora koutou, everybody. Welcome to this week's Q+A Business Podcast. Well, one big topic dominating politics in the business world, and that is the issue of a capital gains tax, with the tax working group led by Sir Michael Cullen releasing the details of its final report that has gone to the government, which will then decide whether it progresses with his proposals or the group's proposals or not. So no decisions are made as of yet, but we do know that a capital gains tax of sorts is being recommended. It effectively extends the number of assets or things that would be caught by that tax paid at the marginal rate. So we would start to see investment property, business assets, farms, these sorts of things included, family home not included, personal assets and those sorts of things. But Sir Michael Cullen came by the studio here at TVNZ not long after making the announcement earlier this morning, and he sat down to explain how it would work, and also, I guess, how he felt the debate might play out as a politically charged one. His own government in 2007 didn't do it. So an interesting and a pretty frank discussion with Sir Michael Cullen. Well, Sir Michael Cullen, thank you very much for joining us ahead of your with the release of your tax working group only an hour or so ago.
Yep.
You've pretty much stuck to the proposal from the interim report, but for people who are not familiar, you are proposing the extension, well, we don't technically call it a capital gains tax, do you, or do you?
Well, I think the problem with calling it a capital gains tax is it sounds like it's a separate tax, and one of the key things that's underlying the recommendations is that we're extending the boundary of what is taxed into more of capital income. What most people, I think, don't think understand is that under our tax system, income is divided into two sorts of things. Income that's on revenue account for companies, income that's on capital account. And basically, the first lot's largely taxed, pretty much. The second lot largely isn't. And this is trying to shift that boundary across so we're taxing more of capital income.
Let's go through some of those.
But it comes in the form of capital gains, basically.
Sure. Let's go through some of those. So the key ones being, we know the family home is not included, but residential property, investment property would be. How would it be different under what you're proposing than the bright line test they've got at the moment of five years?
Well, first of all, it's integrated with the income tax system, which I think the current bright line test is as well in terms of the rates. But it doesn't have any kind of time limits and so on. I mean, this is the important thing, I think, for people to understand. The first thing that people really need to understand is what's happened in the past, what happens up to whenever this act comes into force, if it ever does, is irrelevant.
Right, so this is important. So if somebody has a second to an investment property, they've made quite a lot of money probably over the last 10 years or so, they're not going to be taxed on that bit.
No, they're going to be taxed on the gain in the value of that property from, let's say, 1 April 2021, which is the earliest possible date this could come into force, could quite well be later, through to whenever they sell. So even if they sell between now and 1 April 2021,
they get the lot.
There'd be no capital gains tax applying.
So what else is in? The boat, the jewellery, that's not?
Personal assets like boats, cars, jewellery, paintings, etc., they're out. In businesses, goodwill, lands and buildings, and so on, is in. So those are the sort of
And so why do that? I mean, one of the reasons that people often talk about a capital gains tax in New Zealand is that it's to help lift productivity.
Right.
So why add this tax to business, which presumably you're wanting people to stop investing in investment property and invest more in business? Would this not discourage that?
There's an issue that people have said this would raise the cost of capital. But when you look overseas, there's a real relationship between even the rates of capital gains tax and whether those countries are high productivity countries or medium productivity countries. I mean, we say we're low productivity, that's a bit naughty, we're not. I mean, by full international standards, we're a medium.
Top 30 countries or something.
That's right. We're not a low productivity country like India or Zambia or somewhere like that. But when you, as I say, when you look at the overseas experience, there seems to be very little relationship. And I think one of the reasons for that is that actually, often countries where there's more taxes actually are able to afford better education and training systems, better infrastructure. So for businesses, these are major parts of their input costs and major contributors to their efficiency. I mean, nobody would claim that our infrastructure is very good in New Zealand. And there are a lot of problems with our our education system, particularly with our technical education system, which is sort of withered.
You're arguing that they'll get better workers, better infrastructure,
and so on. I wouldn't push that argument too hard, but it's a counter argument which assumes that any increase in tax is somehow negative. It depends what is being done.
But what about the business? So what about the practice of business owners who, you know, pay themselves virtually no salary, they work 24 hours a day or whatever, with the mindset that they're going to sell their business in 10, 20 years' time, make their capital gain and then move on? And they're going to have to change that, aren't they?
A really good idea to break that mindset and actually get people paying themselves properly, not being silly about paying 33 cents to the dollar in the tax rather than 28, because it's really a pretty marginal difference once you get up into those higher levels, and actually invest and move to increase their productivity. I mean, it's Ralph Waters, formerly the head of Fletcher's, has been sort of pushing this message in New Zealand for years, being an ex-Australian. He says, we take it too easy. We think in New Zealand that the government's job is just to produce a cheap labour force and get out of the way. And that just makes us lazy about productivity growth. We would have better productivity growth, in fact, if people looked and said, we've got more expensive labour. We need to make sure we use that labour more effectively.
I want to come back.
It's a mindset that
no, but I think
in,
the mindsets are important.
Helpful.
I think they're important. I think they're important because, you know, one of the main arguments against a capital gains tax already is that that it's the envy tax, but not just that it's that it's disincentivizing people's ambition, that it's encouraging people not to push
the
strive,
argument.
The aspiration, and might it actually lead to, you know, people saying, business is going to be taxed?
My response to them is a couple of things. Firstly, you can't have it both ways. It can't be something which is basically levered entirely on the middle class, which is one story that's out there, and it's an envy tax of the wealthy. I mean, those two things are two different statements. The latter, in one way, you could argue, has more basis, in fact, in that the great bulk of the income will come from those with large assets. And there's any number of tables and data in the report which underlie that. All overseas experience shows that very, very clearly. But I really say to somebody, so you're really telling me that you don't want to own an asset worth $10 million. You'd rather have zero than pay $3.3 million out of the $10 million in tax, or 2.8 if it's the corporate tax rate, in the future. So you'd rather have nothing than $6.7 million. Now, I have to say, as somebody who doesn't owe either of those, but somewhere between, I find that an incredible assertion to make. It's like sort of aspiration.
So
depends.
People will adjust, that's what you're saying?
People will adjust, absolutely. Absolutely, people adjust. I mean, you look overseas, our countries like UK, US, France, Italy, Germany, all the Nordics, and so on, all of whom have capital gains taxes, is there a clear indication that everybody's sitting back on their heels and saying, I don't want to be rich, when in all those countries there's debate about the increasing inequality of wealth, as there is throughout much of the Western world. So it simply isn't true that if you take some modest increase in taxation, and remember, for most people, this is a rare event in their lifetime. At one time in their life, they might have a substantial capital gain, and they're going to be taxed at that point on that income. Most of the time, they're going to be paying the same or less tax than they do at present, depending on how the revenue readjustments occur. The problem is, if we allow these arguments to get carried away and the capital gains tax shrinks and shrinks and shrinks to very little, and you're hearing some people saying, well, it should only be on rental property, because we know that that's very much.
But you've given that option to the government, or you've said that they could.
I've said they could choose certain classes, but if I'm expressing my own view, then I think you've got a real peculiar fairness argument to engage in. So you're saying that you would tax families, people. We always say mums and dads for some reason, so everybody who owns two or three houses are mums and dads, but they may well not be. Owners of two or three rental properties, you tax them because we're under-taxing because we don't tax their capital gains. But then somebody who's got a multi-million dollar holiday home sitting on prime real estate, which may in 50 years' time not be prime real estate with global warming, but that's another issue, and they make possibly a $5 million profit on selling a place they only use for a few weeks a year shouldn't pay tax. Now, I think that would breach any kind of test of fairness. So you come across into that. And then we come to the vexed issue of the primary sectors, where you've got land values over decades increasing faster than general prices or indeed general asset values. So people actually engage in them because they're expecting a capital gain when they sell at the end. Do we actually want this to continue ever more in the day? And what this is doing, it's shrinking the number of family farms, because ordinary family farmers can't afford to buy into the business.
It's interesting.
If they're not already in it, they can't get in it just about.
I mean, I know this isn't your domain, but Winston Peters has already seems to have expressed some reservations about farms. That's obviously going to be a sticking point.
Right, but let's remember what the actual proposal is. Suppose you leave in your will your farm to your children or one of your children or whatever. That is subject to rollover relief. Exemption for the family home and the 4,500 square metres around it, that's exempt. The rest, rollover relief. No capital gains tax payable at that point. It's only if somebody in the future sells that land to a corporate, possibly an offshore corporate. So I'll say to Winston, well, think about this, Winston. You don't want to so structure it that if the family farms start getting sold to offshore corporates, we won't mention any particular country in the current circumstance, you're saying there should be no tax payable. I think Kiwa might come back and think, that doesn't seem right. We actually want to encourage family farms. There's a rollover relief for active businesses, which includes farming, obviously, where the turnover is under $5 million a year. Now, I haven't seen the sums, but I suspect a lot of family farms, even though they tend to get bigger, their turnover will be under $5 million a year. That's a pretty high turnover.
So there are exemptions there.
There are exemptions, there's rollover relief. But when you come to the point of realisation and sale, and there's also exemptions which in the case of the farmer with that $5 million, it's also if you put that money either into another farm. So if you're a farmer, a family farmer says, okay, I want to sell my farm because the one down the road suits me better in terms of what I'm trying to do. Goes and buys that, has to take out a mortgage from next to a few million dollars or something to pay it. He or she will get rollover relief.
They don't get whacked on the
capital
gain.
They get rollover relief on the capital gain on that first farm. So I suppose my own sort of semi-public, semi-private appeal to the government is, well, you may feel you need to make some concessions, but at least have them on a rational basis, on a coherent basis. And in my view, just stopping, say, at residential rental property isn't coherent, because the next set of assets clearly come into a category. You could take out active businesses other than land and buildings, that part of the value, but the active business value itself, the goodwill and all that stuff.
Because that's complex, right?
That's complex. So you might say, oh, it's not, the extra there isn't worth the candle, so we'll take that back. You might decide that maybe you don't want to get into the equities and those other savings areas because maybe it might be a discouragement. We've got enough trouble persuading Kiwis to save. We don't want to get a picture that you're going to get absolutely clobbered on your savings. You might take that out. That still leaves you a sort of coherent package which you could do. And I, incidentally, if you had the land and buildings across the board in, you still get about 60% of the total revenue.
Which is where I was going to come to next, which is you have recommended a number of options for potential income tax cuts to compensate wage earners.
Right.
Is that, you know, realistic? We're talking $15 a week under the best scenario?
Yeah, best scenario, because we were asked to produce a revenue neutral 5-year program, because obviously the revenue builds up over time as these assets gain in value and then are sold starting from 2021. The revenue in the first year is very small. So revenue in the first 5 years averages about $1.6 or so billion dollars. That's what you could say you could structure a revenue package around. Well, that's about 2% of total government revenue or spending. So it's not a big deal in the total picture. It's not as kind of deal breaker saying we can, you know, abolish the bottom tax rate completely or something big like that.
That comes to an interesting point, because you do point out in the report that it could push up rents and it could push down house prices.
Yes, there's theoretical modelling that says that. The practical experience offshore seems to show in countries which have introduced this kind of tax, very, very little effect. Pardon me. And there's also a theoretical argument that if you could push rents up, why don't they do it now? But I think the balance of view of pretty much the whole group was that the evidence didn't actually suggest it would happen. Despite the modelling, but the problem with modelling is that it often generates things which actually don't happen in the real world. And in the real world, where South Africa, Canada, other countries in more recent times have introduced capital income taxation, it seems to have been no significant impact on rents or house prices at all. I would hope that if we had more capital income taxation on land in general, that over the longer term, this would significantly impact upon the rate of price inflation of land, because that generation of the unearned increment in land values over decades and decades in New Zealand is a major generator of our economic imbalances. But it encourages investment for capital gains rather than for productive use and for best economic or social use. It encourages over-intensification of farming. The result of all of that is you see house prices in Auckland and Tauranga and Hamilton and elsewhere just moving beyond the reach of even middle-class people trying to enter the housing market. Now, you don't want to argue for a housing price collapse. That would be disastrous. But you do want to see, not shock horror probe like the New Zealand Herald at times in the last few weeks, Auckland house prices have stayed stable for 6 months as though this is a sort of disaster. You want to say, wouldn't it be nice if house prices stay pretty much stable in Auckland for the next 20, 25 years and incomes began to catch up so that people can afford to get into houses and people who want to buy houses to rent don't have to charge such high rents for them.
Almost finished. What would you say to the likes of Simon Bridges, who I think have said today this goes against the Kiwi way of life? I've seen that comment a few times.
Dear. Yeah, well, it's like sort of fart taxes, so-called, we're supposed to go against the Kiwi way of life and so on and so on. This sort of myth we all owned batches at one point in the past. I mean, I grew up in an era of North Christchurch, which actually no longer exists. It was a residential era in North Christchurch.
But even
where none of us own batches.
Yeah, but that's the point.
I went to a school where most people own.
Come back to his point, though. It's not just that whether you own a batch, it's whether you aspire to own that batch and believe you should be able to own that batch and then get the rewards for it.
But the aspiration is never going to happen. The cost of owning those holiday homes, which are usually fairly substantial residences these days, has moved well beyond the average income household.
Yeah, but what if that aspiration is the thing that drives someone to be more productive and work really hard? And they, if you take that aspirational reward away from them, that's the tax argument, isn't it? They won't work as hard.
And yet the evidence is remarkably slim. I mean, look what's happened in New Zealand over the last 25, 30 years. We've slashed corporate taxation. We've slashed personal taxes from 66 to 33 cents and then put it up to 39 and then back to 33. And none of those moves had a discernible effect at all on people's productivity. I mean, whether their aspiration, the perspiration ran out before the aspiration did or something in terms of working harder, I don't know. But the reality is that most people work hard. Most people put in the best effort that they can, but we're poor and investing in productivity growth, and we need to improve that. But unfortunately, marginal changes in corporate tax rates or in personal tax rates seem to have very, very little impact.
We won't go into great detail on this, but you did look at environmental tax issues.
Yes.
You have made some recommendations, but are they probably a bit more outside of scope for the government?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I think strengthening the ETS to make it behave more like a carbon tax is entirely consistent with current government policy, and the revenue from that could be useful.
Well, that might be, but I did see Grant Robertson squirming a bit on the issue of congestion taxes and those sort of things.
Well, the government's been doing work on congestion taxes. I'd express a personal view. I'm on the board of Auckland Transport, as well as having done this job. And I would like to see a congestion tax in Auckland, which could be used to replace the regional fuel tax, because it would be much more finely tuned instrument and be much more of both carrot and stick to enable a move into public transport, reduction in congestion, reduction in carbon emissions. I mean, it's a kind of win-win-win.
And that was Sir Michael Cullen, the head of the tax working group. And look, we're going to be covering this issue of the capital gains tax in some depth over the next few weeks, both on the business podcast and on Q&A, because it's a very important debate. So rest assured, you will hear plenty from the opponents of this scheme and also those who are supporting it. So we'll get a balanced debate, do the best we can so that New Zealanders get a good understanding of what's being proposed here. Of course, ultimately, it will be up to the government to make that final call, and they'll do so in April. That's it for this week's Q&A Business Podcast. We'll catch you again soon. Cheers.